Thank you. Hey, good evening, everyone. Hello, good evening. Welcome to the Enoch Pratt Free Library. I am Heidi Daniel, President and CEO. And I want to thank you for being here this evening for a special edition of Pratt's Writers Live featuring National Book Award winner, James McBride. Yay. I want to thank all of our private donors who make free events like this possible here at the Enoch Pratt Free Library. I also want to thank our programming staff, especially Cleve Corner and Sophia Nawali, for their work on tonight's event and all of our amazing speakers. We have just wrapped up a record-breaking summer at Pratt with 20,000 participants in our Summer Break Baltimore program. And there is a t-shirt in the audience. I'm not going to point you out, but I see you sitting there in your summer break t-shirt. It's awesome. And everybody loved those t-shirts. So we actually sold out of the t-shirts too. And they were free. We have an action-packed fall coming up with programs throughout September and October. And we are welcoming speakers like comedian and former Saturday Night Live star Leslie Jones, best-selling young adult author R.L. Stine, who gave me goosebumps through my entire childhood, actress Jada Pinkett Smith, and ballerina Misty Copeland. I know, right? We've also got lots of back-to-school events, including one next week on September 11th, where we'll partner with Kennedy Krieger to learn more about the effects of books, literacy, and screen time on your children's brain. And on September 14th, we'll celebrate the 50th anniversary of hip-hop with a grand battle of DJs, bringing together legendary and rising DJs from all across Baltimore City. I hope to see you at some of our upcoming events, and you can find out more in our Compass magazine or on our website at prattlibrary.org. But please do take a Compass if you don't already have one, because it's also just a great publication. Now, for tonight's event, James McBride is an award-winning author, musician, and screenwriter. His memoir, The Color of Water, spent 2 years on the New York Times bestseller list. His debut novel, Miracle on St. Anna, was turned into a major motion picture directed by Spike Lee. His 2013 novel, The Good Lord Bird, won the National Book Award for Fiction. And now his latest book, The Heaven and Earth Grocery Store, has critics calling McBride America's storyteller in chief. You can pick up a copy from our friends at Greedy Reads. Tonight, he is in conversation with award-winning author Danielle Evans. Please welcome Mr. James McBride and Danielle Evans to the Pratt stage.
Hi, how are you doing?
Hello, it's all of you. Thank you all. Thank you for being here, and thank you for being with us in Baltimore to talk about this beautiful book. I wanted to start with a question. I heard you in a couple of interviews give a really beautiful explanation that one of the characters in the book is partly based on you imagining your grandmother's life and trying to write a kind of better, gentler life in fiction than she got in reality. I thought that was a really moving explanation, but I think for most writers, when you're writing anything that's drawn from life, there's a balancing act of preserving the record of things that people might forget, and sometimes adding drama that didn't happen for the sake of plot, and sometimes creating possibility and tenderness. And I think that as a writer, you seem really drawn to those moments of creating possibility and tenderness that people might not have gotten to experience in their actual lived experience. So I wondered if you could talk a little bit about that and its role in getting you to this particular book.
Well, you're so smart, I don't even know what you were asking me. I think what you're saying is that when I made a comment about my grandmother.
Yeah, in a couple of interviews you talked about just trying to write a better life than she got.
Well, I mean, in real life, you know, Huda Shilsky was a Jew from Europe, from Poland, who came here, settled in Suffolk, Virginia, and ran a grocery store with her husband, who was a, you know, called himself a rabbi, but really wasn't a man of God very much. And, her only son ran away when he was 15 and joined the army. He was killed in World War II. His body wasn't found for many years. And her eldest daughter, my mother Ruth, ran away when she was 18 and never came home. So when my grandmother died, when I went to research The Color of Water, I met many people down there, old Jewish people and black people who remembered her with great fondness because she was very kind. And she had a very difficult life. So I've said it before, I put her on the page because she didn't have love in her. Her husband didn't love her, so I put her on the page and I made her loved. But that said, you know, once Shona, or Hannah, if you would, you know, that's the Jewish way of saying it. Once she got on the page, she took her own, you know, she began to spin on her own orbit. I wasn't like writing her so that I could pretend that my grandmother would have a better life. Fiction doesn't really work that way. Fiction is the characters kind of arrive. And, you know, when I used to hear writers say this, I'd say, you know, I'm following my characters. And blah, blah. I'd say, yeah, right. Yeah, sure you are, buddy. You know, I paid $17 for that book. I'm following something. But no. But in reality, what happens is in good fiction, characters begin to create story. And when Shona arrived in Moshe's life, she began to create. Their love spun out and created an enormous amount of momentum that allowed the story to just shove forward and gave it the momentum so that when the conflict was introduced in the form of Dodo, and it already had plenty of momentum so that when it spilled into the black community, it was still moving on its own power.
Yeah, and I think there's something really, I mean, there is a lot of heartbreak in this book, but there's also a lot of opportunity for tenderness and intersection and kind of movement across communities that we might think of as divided. Did that sort of generate from characters and thinking about where people might have an opportunity to kind of see each other in an intimate human setting?
Well, I don't, you know, if I thought about books the way you did, I wouldn't be able to finish it. You know, really, I mean, I don't really go that deep with it, you know what I mean? I'm not, I'm just, I'm not, I'm not trying to be funny. I'm just saying, you know, you're much more heady than I am. I don't have the, I'm not that smart. You know, I just want, you know, I know what I'm really writing about. And in this case, I was really writing about equality. So at bottom, it was really about equality. To me, I don't really care about the, I mean, I love the characters and some I don't love, but I always try to explain to people what they're seeing. It's sort of like when people get into a car accident, you know, you see them after they have a fender bender and they go, you see them, they go, your mother, what? And then so that's the image you have of those people. But that's not who they really are. If you ask their mother who they are, they say, oh, you know, my mother's. So I try to get through all that nonsense and just get to like, what is drawing people? What is the magnet that draws people together? And that magnet is very simple. It's love. Love doesn't require a whole lot of, hate requires a lot of diesel fuel. You have to really pump it up. You have to charge it all the time. You got to, this is why, you know, this is why we're going to win. Okay. In real life, because we just can't sustain hate that long. Love is slow, but love is powerful. So that's really what I'm moving towards in this book, you know, really about equality and, you know, the disabled and so forth.
Yeah, this book is also, it is a loving portrait of a complicated community, but a particularly complicated Jewish immigrant community. And I wondered, you've written about your own complicated relationship to Jewish identity and the color of water and the way your mother got cut off from that. So what was it like to fictionally inhabit that community?
I mean, you know, my life is not, my life, even when I was a young man and I was writing The Color of Water, I didn't really feel like, I wasn't like one of these people that's rent between like, you know, should I eat matzo balls or fried chicken? I wasn't like a tragic mulatto staggering through life trying to decide whether to, you know, should I be gefilte fish or shrimp. I was just sort of like, this is why mommy was so smart, because she just appreciated the smallest things. She didn't really waste time with, I mean, you know, she just didn't waste time on stuff that people waste time on. And so I'm that same way. So, you know, I'm not like a good person to be on the committee of the mixed race people who decide, you know, whether they're going to say he, she, they, what, if, water. And I ain't that guy. Because if you, I don't get, whatever you are, ain't hurting me. So I just think that in my mother's case, she didn't complain a lot about her life. Well, she did complain. But she wasn't the person who just said, you know, oh, well, she just, what's the solution? She was interested. And so that's what I'm interested in. I'm interested in solutions. I don't like to write books where, you know, people's get heads lopped off or, you know, justice is delivered and the guy dies at the end. Because look, if you shoot someone, you take everything they have and everything they'll ever have. And then, you know, that just doesn't stop. It reverberates. I was talking to a person today. She said, when her husband was alive, you know, he didn't have the same experience with the Black community that's reflected in this book. He got beat up, whatever it was, you know. And that kind of activity, that can ping for generations. Yet, the woman was here saying to me, I loved your book. So which narrative do you follow? I always follow the narrative that says the woman came here to say to me, thank you for writing the book, knowing that her past husband, her husband passed away, suffered as a result of some evil or some cruelty on the part of a Black person. I mean, I saw my mother get abused all the time by, you know, both sides, white and Black. She just forgot all about it. And forgetting all about it is almost as good as forgiven. You know, it's just like, you know, she'd get on the subway. I've told the story. On the subway with her and these guys started calling her the N-word and all this. And I said to her, I asked Ma, later, I said, Ma, why people shouldn't be talking? Why you let people talk to you like that? She said, their names can't hurt me. Did you do your homework? What was your homework? Did you do it? She was only interested in solutions. And so some of this stuff you have to roll off your back. You pick your battles. And otherwise, you know, I've always been comfortable with Black life. I've never been one of those people who tries to be like, you know, super Black or super white. I mean, I grew up in Black America. It's always been good to me. I mean, sometimes it hasn't been. I mean, you know, in my church, you know, some of the people in my church really, I mean, really. But, you know, I've always had probably a deeper appreciation and curiosity about Jewish life because of my own life. And as I was saying earlier to the many of the donors of the library, many of whom apparently happened to be Jewish. I mean, not all though. I mean, but my point is that, you know, I've always been curious about my Jewish past because it's part of who I am. I think it's important to just celebrate whoever you are. I mean, how hard can it be to celebrate, somebody else's culture? My neighborhood in Brooklyn is mostly Spanish. When I say Spanish, I mean, you know, I don't have Latino, you know what I mean. You know, you're not supposed to say Latino, you're supposed to say Latinx. I don't get lost in the Kleenex of that. You know, if you're a decent person, it's all, you know, but I celebrate all that stuff. Puerto Rican Day Festival, I'm in all of it. I love it. I mean, because I know that there's no real difference between us. So that's how I work it.
I think one of the things that's so beautiful about all of your work is that you have this way of bringing such different places to life really vividly, but also you're also interested in those spaces where people are talking to each other, just sort of in conversation, in community, where people we might not expect to be together are together. And I think there's such a vibrant setting in this book, and I wondered if you could talk a little bit about how you drew this picture of Pottstown, like what came to you first, or how you arrived at kind of making this town come alive.
Well, this book began as an ode to a guy named Cy Friend, who was ran a camp so-called disabled children that I worked at in outside Philly when I was in college, and in 4 summers when I was in college. And Cy, the children changed my life. Because I realized then I would never really understand what normal means. You know, what is normal? You know? And so, you know, the idea of like a person who has a physical disability having 1,000 thoughts in their mind and only one small bit of it being able to express even that much to a person is gold to them. And if you can get it, it's gold to you. And the gold, usually it's a big chunk of gold for you and just a small chunk of, because they're giving you more than you ever get back. So the lesson of that, I tried to put into a book, but it ended up being a book about camp. And it just wasn't any good. And the only good chapter was the chapter where I talk about the person who donated the land for the camp, and that was Moshe. So I discarded all that stuff and just started in at Moshe. And then from there, you know, once Shona rolled into his life, then I just followed the bouncing ball.
So when you say the book wasn't very good, I feel it's probably worlds better than most of us would do in a first draft. So I'm wondering, for your personal standards, when do you know when something's working? Like, when do you know when the heart of the story is there? When do you know that you're in something that you can work with as a writer?
When I want to read it again. If I have to force myself to read it, you know, then it's no good. I mean. And so I just wasn't feeling the characters. I wasn't feeling, I reworked it several different ways because it's always about entry point in a story. You know, your entry point is, you know, you have to figure out how to get the reader. You know, you have a keyhole. You're trying to shove the reader into this tiny keyhole and drop them into the room. Once you get them into the room, you know, the chances are they'll stay, but getting them there. And so how do you do it? And so you're trying to like figure out some element of conflict or some element of some slight bump in the road that would allow the reader to say, I'm gonna follow this thread. And so in the case of this book, it was all about Moshe planning this big festival of Yiddish music and fun and frolic of the old country. Because look, I don't want to insult anybody, okay? So this is just my prejudice. Jewish people are very funny. I mean, now it doesn't mean that black people are not, they're very funny, and Irish people, I mean, come on, and Italians, wow. But just in my experience, you know, when you get, Jewish people can be very funny. So it to me, this guy is planning this big festival frolic, and then it becomes like, it goes out of control. It's just great. It's just a great way to get into this world and show it in a way that's fun, but also educational and also, you know, spiritual and real. I mean, I did that with Deacon King Kong, and I did it with the Good Lord Bird. Deacon King Kong books, all kinds of fun at the Black Church, and this book, folks. Just take several deep jabs at shettles and, you know, Jewish shuls and so forth. because in those days everyone was broke. And so everyone was just doing whatever they could to get, you know, to get things going.
One of the things I loved about Mushi's theater was that we got these scenes of performance or backstage with the bands. As someone who's a practicing musician as well as a writer, why do you have so many talents? That's my question. Like, but my other question, my book-related question, is were there any scenes that were particularly fun to write as someone who has also toured and performed?
What was particularly fun?
And any of the theater scenes, any of the band scenes?
Oh, the band scene. Well, I really enjoy writing the scene about where the great American Cuban trumpet player. Was it Machito? I can't remember at my age, with Lionel Hampton's wife. Lionel Hampton's wife was legendary. And you know, I mean, as a musician, you know, you talk to promoters, and some of these promoters are really just rough people, but some are very funny, at least in the past. And so Moshe was a promoter. He wasn't like really, Shona was the one with the spine. Moshe was just trying to get things, you know, he was a deal maker and sometimes it worked out. So the scene where he has to talk to the Cube, they're fighting about who's going to open because Louis Armstrong can't make it. And then I can't remember the trumpet player's name, Machito, or the great American Cuban trumpet player, takes him into the hall and has him listen. And he listens and he hears all this Spanish talking. And then Moshe says, "What is that?" And Machito says, "It's the future." And, you know, I remember talking to Jerome Richardson, who was a great saxophone player. Play with, you know, Quincy Jones and all these guys and Lionel Hampton's band. He said they opened for Tito Puente one time. They were supposed to play with Tito Puente, and nobody had heard of this guy. And so they said Tito, you go first. And Tito Puente said, okay. And he said, man, Jerome said, when they got on stage, they just peeled the wallpaper off the walls. he said Gates didn't know what Lionel Hampton, they called him Gates. He said Gates didn't know what to do. Because they just, Tito and his Puerto Ricans, they just killed it. So, you know, I was drawing on that.
I also loved, there's a lot of gossip and storytelling that happens in this book. There's a character called Paper because she's always got the news and she's sort of going from place to place. But there are lots of characters who are sort of gathering information in different ways. And so sometimes you'll hear the same story heard by different people in the community or even different segments of the community. Sometimes somebody will actually keep something a secret until it's an important plot point. Sometimes people just sort of have things they know that nobody else knows. And I wondered when you're thinking of all these sort of vibrant settings you make and all the sort of people you put into community together, do you think about gossip and storytelling as part of the setting?
Well, once again, you know, Professor, that I'm not making fun of you, honestly. I'm just saying, you know, the way you think, you're so analytical, and that's an important tool, and unfortunately, not one that I possess. But how it works is this: it really boils down to who's in the room. You know, when you do TV writing, for example, there's always like the question of who's in the room when this is happening. It's all about point of view. Every story is about point of view. I mean, there's 200 people in here. 200 people are going to walk out with 200 different, you know, versions of what they just saw. So when you introduce a conflict into a situation, you know, the waves that, you know, the pinging explosion will send, you know, send, just imagine a pond, someone drops a rock and then the waves move out. Well, if you're standing on this side of it, the wave's a little different than that. So if you can, you try to connect all of these different perspectives to that one incident or that one series of actions. And in this case, it was all about, you know, Shona's insistence that she take this kid into her house. And she makes that decision in an instant. And then, you know, all of this other stuff. How many of us have made a small decision that turns out to be a big? I mean, you know, people ask me all the time, how did you become a musician and a writer? Well, I mean, the short answer is I've always managed to do what I want to do. In other words, you know, I don't mind quitting. I never minded quitting. I wouldn't tell my mother, but I would just quit a job. And she would still think I'm working at the job until somebody says, well, you know, James ain't in Boston no more. But I always made a living because I always did what I wanted to do. So, but I'm digressing. I think I answered your question.
Yeah. I think there's a way that, so Shona is helping Dodo and her neighbor is also helping Dodo, and they sort of are in this conspiracy together, but they still don't really talk to each other. They had a friendship at one point, they fell out. And there's something interesting about the way that they're sort of able to collaborate but not communicate until later in the book.
Well, I mean, Bernice is a complicated character. Bernice was Shona's friend from childhood. Because at a certain point in that book, when Bernice and Shona's friendship splits apart in high school, Shona's at a point where she's starting to see the life ahead of her. And she's not really happy about what she sees. A dad wants her to marry. Somebody, her parents wanted to marry her. They're trying to set her up in an arranged marriage. And she's starting to see the town for what it is. And she doesn't like the anti-Semitism. She doesn't like the racism. She doesn't like a lot of it because she grew up in this Black community where she knew everybody and everyone knew her. Bernice, on the other hand, you know, she's experienced, you know, this whole business of what an integrated school meant back then, which meant that if you were Black, just be quiet and do the best you can because you know the teacher's not going to lie. You know, I'm sure that that's what integrated schools were like in Pottstown. I met people in Pottstown who say, you know, the schools were integrated, everything was good, da da da. Well, all the Black people who went to those schools ain't saying that. So Bernice's experience pushed her, you know, gave her that shove into the out of the white world into the Black world, and then she closed down. She lost her father, she lost her mother, her brother went to jail. See, these are things that they're not on the page, but they're in my head. And she was a beauty. She was a physically just a beautiful woman. So men are running with gifts and da da da, and they get her pregnant and they cut out. And she just takes this all standing up. And when Shona shows up later, she basically is returning the favor of friendship that Shona's parents had bestowed on her when her daddy died. And so, and Shona and Bernice is a hard woman. I try not to push too deep into backstory with characters because then you lose the flow. But Bernice is a hard woman. And she explains to her brother at one point when they start talking, she says, you know, I'm a hard woman because I lived a hard life. I can't remember what I wrote, but you know, whatever it is. She explains to Fatty why she is the way she is. They have this big fight, you know. So, but both of these women have suffered. And their suffering has given them some sense of power. Because that's the difference between men and women in that women, now let me just be careful now, because I you know, but the women in my books have taken a hit and know, and they can get up off the canvas. Men take a hit and they pull out their guns, they start shooting. That, you know, I mean, it's just a whole, it's a different emotional elements at play.
So don't get mad at me because I'm asking you a question about metaphor. But I really love the way that water worked in this book. That it's there's you know water as cataclysmic storm. There's water as a purification, but there's also just a really grounded plot about water and sewer lines. And I like the way that tethered that metaphoric association with water that we get from our literary critical reading to like the actual human experience of like who owns the water lines and where are they running them? And how do you fix a broken water line? And the way those things merged together felt really beautiful to me. And I know that it's really hard. You don't want to write toward a metaphor because then it takes over the book, but was there a point at which you thought about the different ways water was working?
Well, no, I didn't really at all. I mean, what college did you go to now? All right, well, no, you know, there are different devices that you use, you know. I think his name is Heinrich von Kleist wrote a book called The Marquis of O. And it's a series of short stories. I heard E.L. Doctorow mention it one time, and I looked it up, and it was good. About a guy who loses his, someone takes his horses and messes with his horses. And then the horses become, you know, just explodes into the lack of justice that he doesn't get because of what happened to his horses. In the case of there's always devices when you have a novel moving along. And water was just a device. It was just a device that, I needed something. I can't remember what the problem was, but engaging Fatty and Big Soap toward the end of the book, because at one point I needed Isaac and Nate to come together, because Isaac and Nate represent different parts of unhappiness. Isaac was, Isaac, they were both powerful, but Isaac was powerful because he was rich and he was unhappy. Nate was powerful because he could kill people. they were both miserable in their unhappiness. And so they have a big meeting. And that chapter, you know, I mean, if you read it, that's what I'm, that's really the underlying flow of that.
I don't want to give away too much of the scene surrounding it, because it's a really beautiful moment if people haven't had a chance to read the book yet. But there's a moment toward the end of the book where Shauna thinks about the future, and she thinks explicitly, the narration kind of steps in and says, like, all of these complicated lives and all of the sort of hardship these communities have been through is going to be reduced and forgotten and used in problematic ways. And there's a gesture toward all of the things that are sort of going to come in place of complexity and community and love and the things that are at the heart of the book. And I feel like a lot of us feel that way about whatever our work is, but especially if our work is something artistic. How do you write through this sense of despair? How do you write through this sense of things are going to be misused before you can get them on the page? How do you write?
I don't feel no despair. I mean, I can tell you that right now. You know, I feel a sense of embattlement, you know, a sense of, you know, hope, sense of positivity. I don't feel no despair what's going on in this society. I'm glad to have a wall to push against. It gets me out of bed in the morning. It's the prayer on my lips at night. I say, Lord, let me be a blessing to somebody. I'm glad they let that rascal become president. So now white folks can see what we in New York have been seeing most of my life. You know, let it roll as it is. You know, let it roll as it is. I mean, I said this earlier. You know, you draw the line in the sand when it comes to libraries and bookstores and teachers. I mean, that's where you say, okay, now we got to stop now. And so, you know, I don't have no hate toward nobody. I've had a lot of friends, even family members, honest, who are Trumpers. Good for them. I don't hate them none. And, you know, I pick my battles, you know, very, very judiciously. Just because someone's politics is not mine doesn't mean that when Barbara Bush was first lady and laughed at her after she stopped being first lady, she did more, her and her daughter, Lauren Bush, did more for libraries and reading than any first lady that I can think of. They were really into books. And when they had something, I showed up. And my friends say, Republican this, Republican. I said, look, I don't care. If they're helping people learn to read, put my name down in capital letters. Now, with, you know, the current stuff that's going on, well, let it roll as it is. But we really, and you know, people have their political beliefs. It's all right. But at some point, you got to pick up your sword and start swinging. And that sign, that time has come. So, particularly with regard to books, banning books, and it's all this belligerent, you know, this nonsense of Jesus. What would Jesus do? I ain't interested in what Jesus would do. What would you do? I don't care about the Jesus. Well, I ain't interested in none of that nonsense. And I go to church more than a lot of these Jesus people. So I understand the hypocrisy. I'm not interested in that. I'm just interested in solutions. And so, you know, personally for me, as a person who just loves to see people do well, you know, I'm very aware that the earth is burning, literally. And we're standing and arguing about, you know, the guy who's playing Leonard Bernstein because his nose is too long. You go ahead and have that argument. I'll be in the other room where the real fight's taking place, because that's a distraction. And so much of this distraction keeps us away from the real things that matter. In this book, what really matters is that this boy should not have been put into an institution. And, you know, those of us who are in contact with disabled people who have some experience in my own family, we understand that beneath the exterior of someone who has cerebral palsy or who's deaf or whatever, they're sightless and so forth, there is a glowing human being of enormous power and creativity. And so when this glowing human treasure lands in Shona's house, she sees it. And she says, I'm going to keep it. And her love for what this boy has done for her, because she's a person who's quote unquote disabled as well, when it begins to spill out into the Black community, then that envelops the whole entire community. And that's what makes this book go. And that wasn't intentional on my part. I mean, it was intentional to drop a conflict into this married couple's life. And it turned out to be this, you know, this boy who was hearing disabled or deaf. But what rolled out after that was just the normal color and character that you find in a community like Pottstown.
I think That's such a beautiful place to stop that I'm just going to stop and let the audience ask some questions as you have all well tonight. Thank you so much for that and for this book.
We have time for about 15 minutes for your questions. We have a microphone here and a microphone there. We have about 100 people watching online, so if you have a question, please stand up and come to the microphone.
This is a fellow right up here.
Either one.
I'm curious if you would recommend some other authors for us to read who you think are writing, who are on your wavelength in terms of what you're saying.
Well, I mean, the most obvious one would be William Shirer's The Rise and Fall of the Third Reich. You know, honestly, I mean, I just think that's the book is so well written. And so appropriate to where we are. And when you read about the brown shirts who used to go on bars and kick people around, how they were used, and you see that and you see a policeman roll by, you know. In today's newspaper, one of the guys in the January 6th guys got 22 years. When a black person reads that, they say, well, if it was a black person, he'd be dead anyway. Because if 10 black people attacked the White House, they'd have killed them all. Every black person. So you read that as an African American, you say, well, they gave him 22 years. Probably should have given him life. Or just, you know, throw away the key. So, you know, from a different, when you see world from a different perspective, I can't. So that's why William Shirer's book is an important read, because the dehumanization of Jewish people by the German propaganda machine was effective. And it pervaded every element of German life. And the propaganda that invades us now, some of it religious, is extremely powerful. And needs to be checked. So that's a book I strongly recommend. In terms of novels, to be honest with you, I shouldn't say this because I know there's like people watching online. And now I figured this out. You know, if you say something one place, you go somewhere, they figure they haven't seen it. You know, I'm not a big internet person, so I don't have Instagram and Chattagram and all that gramming. So I would say E.L. Doctorow. E.L. Doctorow's work is wonderful, and you know, and Herman Melville's work makes you feel good about the world, and Robert Carroll's work, Robert Carroll's book, The Power Broker, and his book on Lyndon Johnson. I tend to read more nonfiction than fiction, but Robert Carroll's books are great work, great reading, and Richard Ben Kramer's book, What It Takes, about I forgot what year it was, the presidential race when Biden ran and. I think Biden, Jesse Jackson, Bob Dole, and somebody else. And Richard was, he was just so skilled. He was a wonderful writer. Does that answer your question?
Well, I really wanted to hear what you had to say about Edward Jones or James McPherson. A couple of
Well, I mean, I, you know, I read Edward Jones's, I tried to read his book, but you know, I tell you what, I just checked out when the guy was jacking off on a piece of dirt. That's when I closed the book. Really, I mean, it's just too deep for me. I'm sure he's a great writer. Well, I don't know if he's a great writer or not, because I just wouldn't write a book like that. And I'm just not interested in like that kind of deep. That's just too deep for me. James McPherson, I haven't read. I mean, I see, this is the thing, you know, you start saying what you really think, you know, that's not no good. I mean, Edward Jones is a talent, and, it's just not the kind of book that I would read, you know. What's the point? What are you trying to say to people? I mean, what are you saying? It's sort of like this book, you know, like the guy who wrote Perfect Storm. I mean, as a, you know, great writer, you know. And then he descends like two pages describing what it's like for someone to drown. Now, what's the guy's wife reading this? What does she think? You know, Robert Carroll wrote 1,000 pages on Robert Moses, and Robert Moses was a rascal, man. He was the guy who destroyed a lot of New York City. And, you know, he didn't have to do that. You know, he didn't have to describe, you know, and Robert Moses destroyed lives. And you know, he wrote about Lyndon Johnson. Lyndon Johnson did a lot of good and a lot of bad, but you don't have to go there. You don't have to look. If you're going to write a book, don't play a pop song. You know, if you're going to write Mozart and you say it's Mozart, then it better be Mozart. If it ain't Mozart, don't call it Mozart. just call it what it is. So I don't like those kinds of books. And I'm, you know, my philosophy is, you know, I wouldn't hurt the guy's feelings by saying that to his face. But if I had to, I would, because I don't think you should say that kind of stuff in a book. Have a guy drowning and his lungs is busting out. No, what's the point? I one time met these two writers, right? They were a team. They were like, you know, very famous. I won't name them. And they were like, well, you know, pass the sauce. Is there any more Grey Poupon? And I was like, okay, we're talking. And I read their books, man. The guy's head gets a busting out. You know, the lady gets raped. What are you writing a book like that for? I mean, what's the point? I mean, is it just me? I mean, I'm sitting there, we're having a nice conversation. Me and the young lady is beautiful, and we're talking, and I said, okay, I'll see you later. I'm writing a book. I hope I answered your question.
You did.
Good evening. It's a pleasure to be here. My name is Kelvin Fowler. I find it amazing that you bring up the Bushes and the National Book Festival in Washington, D.C. I've attended several times, met John Hope Franklin, and had a second edition of his book. And he said, John, to his son, this guy has a second edition of my book. It's already worth a lot of money. And now he wants me to sign it. And just to see the audience here with your book in hand, it's gonna be worth a lot of money too. my question, I attended this year with my wife, the book festival, and doing one of the presentations for various artists. They ask, what is your day like? What is your process like on being creative as you are? How do you spend your day on developing your books?
Well, I most of my work is research, you know. I go around, you know, I mean, people don't recognize me on the street. You know, I just go around and I talk to people all the time. And I spend most of my time listening to people. you know, I still take the subway and all that, you know. When I'm on the road, I'm driving all over. Today I went over to the Lloyd Street Synagogue and had some Jewish food over there. It wasn't that good, but, you know, it wasn't as good as... Lenny's is better, but still go over there. I mean, look, the guy's still in business, and the conditions were excellent. So anyway, once I get everything, I'm full here in terms of research, because I go to libraries and historical societies and interview people. Once I'm full up, then I start writing. I've gotten to the point now where I can just fill up, and I always carry a notebook, you know, this is in my backpack. I'm always writing. I always have a pen in my pocket. You know, I never leave my pen anywhere, but, you know, here, always have a notebook somewhere. Oh, here, I have a notebook here. I never leave home without it, right. You know. And I got I got hundreds of these things laying around. And so I write down stuff and I don't even remember. Sometimes I'm like, you know, this is like a grocery list, but I got it. But when I'm writing, I get up at 4:30 in the morning. I just go until I can't go no more. And then I usually just lock myself in my apartment for a couple months. And like, I wrote this book basically over the summer. Right. But I started researching it back in 2008. You know, I went to the Norristown State Hospital and spent 3 or 4 months out there going back and forth, learning about how state hospitals work and all the good people that work there. I met a lot of the patients, met a lot of the staff. And then I put it away and I had to do other stuff. I got divorced, and so then the struggle became very serious. Not that it wasn't serious before, but man, it really got serious now. And then I wrote a couple books at the same time. I wrote the James Brown book and Good Lord Bird. I was working through all the Browns. I was going through the Brown. Yeah. So then I would come back to this book. I could never make it go, so I would set it aside and keep working. So I always got, you know, you're always pregnant, you know. Well, you're not pregnant, ladies. I mean, you always have possibility. And you look at them and you say, this one's birthing. This one's a little close to that one. It's kind of like that. And then when you find one that's starting to catch fire, then you dig in deep. You research it deep. And then hopefully it starts to roll out in a way that's, that works.
Thank you very much.
Mr. McBride, we meet again. I'm Sarah Gladden-Thaniel. I've seen Mr. McBride at least four or five times, I think three times here. The last time was March 6, 2020 in Carroll County for Deacon King Kong. I'm a proud, proud, proud resident of, well, I live in Reisterstown, but I'm straight out of East Baltimore. So my sister was the assistant to the last two directors, not Ms. Daniel, but Dr. Anna Curry, who's deceased, and the Library of Congress director, Dr. Carla Hayden. So my sister is Joanne Mondowney. I saw Ms. Vivian Fisher all the way back over there. You couldn't sneak in, even with that mask, I see you. And Danielle, let me tell you, this man is just trying to play himself really, really, really low, okay? So he's a great citizen of the world. He is such a great storyteller. And my husband's back there, the old dog still hunting back there. So I gotta give it up because he made a lot of sacrifices, and I gotta hear this for the next year that he gave up his part-time job tonight just to drive me down here. So give Thomas Daniel a hand. So I just retired in June. So I've been a special educator for 45 years, the same school. And one of the things I wanted to know, because I would really, really, really like to write a children's book, and I want to write a children's book on Chadwick Boseman. And what I wanted to know, if you have ever written a children's book, and the other thing is, what would be some advice for me that you could give in starting to write one?
I've never written a children's book. and I don't know that I can at this late stage, but I would say that my advice would be to not write down to children.
Okay.
You know, write straight and keep it simple, which is really hard to do. It's a lot, you know, it sounds easy, but it's not.
Right.
But I wouldn't write down the children. I remember when I was young, you know, reading, you know, the books I enjoy were, you know, not Charlotte's Web, but he was an Austrian guy, lived out in California. I can't remember now. My mind is just slipping at this age. But books that spoke to me as opposed to at me. So I would advise that. And I would advise to write every day and rewrite. I rewrite every day.
I do that. I write every day. And I did have my students last year. We did a PBL. And so we did what I called biographical sketches of Boseman's life. So I had them to research it. Of course, I had to research everything myself before I had them to do it. So we have some notes. So anyway, but I have something I'll drop with you later. So keep praying and you know, passing that on, because we don't want all of that talent to go to waste. Pass it on to people like me. So thank you.
All right.
Thank you so much, Mr. McBride. Really appreciated this conversation with you and talking with a fellow writer. It really shed a lot of light on the craft and how diverse it is. I have a question, because you made some very important comments about this whole issue around censoring books and keeping the choices available to all of us of all ages. And you know, a writer like yourself, we certainly would hate to see that people like us or our families would have limited access. How would you as a writer recommend, you know, those of us who are concerned, committed to the Pratt Library, but committed to libraries as a whole, how could we, you know, I don't know, is it something that you see us doing on our own? Is it something that writers like yourselves can work in partnership with us? Because, you know, this whole movement to limit books and limit education, it's not getting smaller, it's getting bigger. Matter of fact, I've even heard some libraries, they've turned them into detention centers so that, you know, rather than let the children in some of the schools have free access to books.
You're referring to what happened in Houston.
Absolutely.
Well, but that's something that we could spend all this time talking about. And I'm here for the cheap, tawdry, you know, element of just selling the book. But I will say this. I was in Houston and I spoke about it. It's happening here in a positive way. When I hear the librarian, the CEO of the library say there's a hip hop event celebrating hip hop 50 years, I'm sure that, like, you know, some of the my senior Jewish brothers and sisters might not make that day. They might not make it. But it's important to know that that culture is what reaches a lot of, not just young people, but a lot of people. And so libraries have to become kind of like community centers, which is, I mean, I'm sure this is one of the best libraries I've ever been to. I mean, and I'm not just saying that. This library, Philadelphia Public Library, New York Public Library, these librarians are serious. They are taking care of business. So now when you go to a place like, I'm not that familiar with Houston or Florida or Mississippi, but I know that there are good people down there who are really overrun. If anything, we just need to pay attention to state government, because state government is powerful. State and local government is really a lot more powerful than we believed. So in terms of the discourse about that, the fact is that the Washington Post, which ran that story, which I think was the original people who put that story together, and it hit the wires and went further. The reason why that what we need to pay attention to is, are we still supporting the Baltimore Sun, which, you know, was one of the great newspapers, created some of the greatest, was and can be again if you subscribe.
Yes.
It's $20, whatever it is. I subscribe to three newspapers. You got to subscribe. We have to make local news again. You can't make social, you just, there's no other way around it. So that's the first thing. The second thing is that, you know, it's one thing to talk about supporting the library. It's a different thing to like write a check to it. And some of us, especially some of us who are older, and I see this in my own church, by the way, you know, in my church, 10 people talk, 2 people do everything. And I'm one of the two. I'm like the janitor, the brunter, and the preacher. You know, I mean, really, 10 people talk, 2 people do everything, and the 2 people, none of them's the preacher. So it's really about those of us who just do it, and don't wait for somebody else to say, let's do it. Just do it and don't wait. Otherwise, you will get overrun. So in terms of what local authors can do and local writers can do, a local writer can't do anything unless they're supported by local people. Local writer here with big time, blah, blah, blah. Okay, but you see how smart this young lady is. And so, you know, she's local here, but if she comes to New York, she's not local. She's national. So treat your local writers. And I know you do that. You try to do that here, and you should continue to do it. I don't think you do anything wrong. I think it's just about adding numbers. And adding numbers in ways that don't make people feel like they're, you know, make people feel welcome, you know? I hope that helps.
We have time for one more question.
Good afternoon, Mr. McBride. Thank you for being here tonight. I should preface this question by saying I'm only up to chapter 9 in the book, but since it's only been out for a short time, I think that's fair. In reading the book, a lot of the characters introduced, it seems like they're very grounded in reality. You already talked about some of the characters like Nate, like Isaac, and how, you know, they're dealing with like a lot of trauma and hardship. And also, like when I was reading about Shona, it seems like a lot of her altruism comes from, you know, the community she was raised in, and then also the fact that she has a physical disability that kind of like encourages her to be like more caring and kind towards others. In the case of the character with Malika, I'm struggling to kind of understand like what is his motivation behind some of his actions. And it seems like he's more based in like magical realism, whereas some of the other characters are more realistic.
Well, that's true. That's a very good point. Malika is one of my favorite characters because I wanted to try to dabble with and push into the magical realism of Judaism and the old Judaic beliefs and superstitions. And so it made him, and also he's important because he represents what do you keep and what do you leave behind. And that way made him key to making that part of the book spin properly. Because Malachi doesn't like America that much. And for Moshe's a greenhorn. They're both greenhorns. But greenhorns mean like you've been new. My mother used to talk about that. You know, no one wanted to be a greenhorn. You wanted to be an American. And Moshe loves American things. But Malachi's not so, and I took Martin Luther King's words and put them in Malachi's mind. And I heard that those words said by Harry Belafonte one time when I was working with David Simon and Taylor Branch, and how Harry Belafonte came into the room to talk to us about Taylor Branch's wonderful book, Parting the Waters. We were trying to do a TV series about it. It didn't happen, but the series didn't happen, but Harry Belafonte came in and he said, Martin Luther King said, you know, I'm afraid we're integrating into a burning house. I took those words and dropped them into Malachi's mouth because the issue is the same. What about America do you keep? What is good about America that you keep, and what is good about it? What are some of the things you don't keep? So that's why Malachi, and you'll see later on that Malachi has a much, because Malachi, you know, I don't want to spoil it for you, but he departs and he goes back home. Goes back to Europe because America's too, you know, kind of dirty for him. I should say that I did a lot of research for this book, as I do for all my books. So I don't tell people, you know, I did research, I was in the library, but I do a tremendous amount of research. And it's about 10% of what I use. I use about 10% of the rest I just don't use. And that was a big problem for Jewish immigrants, you know, because you come here. Everything's clean, it's pure, but there are some things here that just don't. And, you know, when you look at what happened to the Jewish community, and I don't want to insult anybody now, because you can get, you want to see something funny, get two Jews in a room and say, what does it mean to be a Jew? I mean, you know, if you can get them to agree, I'll give you $100 right now. I mean, it just, you know, but the whole splitting off into it, even when I was at the Lloyd Street Synagogue today, you know, there's a reform, and then there's an Orthodox, but it's modern Orthodox. So the women don't have to sit upstairs. I mean, there's a whole stuff about religion that some of it works, some of it doesn't. And so Malachi represents that. I wanted that representation because I wanted it to show what I did in my first book in terms of Judaic and American Jewish life was not a full representation. It was my mother's experience. But it didn't show the joy and sort of the philosophy and the generosity that is part of Judaism. And that's part of Judaism. That's one of the things that Americans really don't get, that part of Judaism is that you must give. That's a Judaic principle. It's a Judaic law. Now, I'm not a rabbi, and I don't want to play on one on TV, but I've read enough about it to know that that is part of what you do. And so Malachi, I wanted that to be represented in some way by Malachi and what he sees about America, this individualism, this, you know, it's all mine, the bread is nice and the place is clean and all that, but what are you leaving? Because that sense of togetherness that Isaac had with Moshe, the two cousins who walked from Romania to Hamburg, I saw that in my own life when I was a young boy at Variety Club Camp, for example. You know, their camp was founded by Romanian Jewish theater owners. And these men were hard men. They were hard. They were very practical, hard men. And they were racist in their own way. But beneath it, they were really good people. And the thing is that when I used to go down south and see my relatives in North Carolina, you know, great uncle Henry and all these, you know, they were hard men and women. And you always got the sense they wanted to come and just spank the crap out of you. But beneath all of it, they were really sophisticated and they were deeply kind. And so you kind of push all that stuff aside. You show it to the reader, you push it aside, and you show that there's just love here. And you use the religion in a way, the religion and culture and customs in a way that allows people to see the common ground, as opposed to using the religion and culture to separate people, which is that what does Jesus do bullshit. That's what that is. Using religious to say, you know, what would Jesus do? Who cares? But when you use it to say what bonds people together, it's the flashlights coming together, then you got something. So does that help?
Thank you.
All right.
I want to take this opportunity to thank our moderator, Danielle Evans. And this evening's author, James McBride.
Thanks.
So, we'll be back in about 10 minutes to sign some books. If you want to line up outside of the auditorium,